Hi guys, okay, we're back with another video on sustainable urban development. This is the part 5 of SUD, team 3.2 for some of you, okay, who knows that, then good for you. Okay, this is going to be on indicators for livability. Alright, in the previous episode, okay, I'll leave a link in the top right corner of the screen, we talked about what urban livability is all about. Okay, so this is where your examples come into play. This is a question, this is the part, right, whereby it can be quite easy to come out as any sort of question as well. It could be case study, it could be in your essay. Indicators is a integral part of livability you need to understand. Don't ever get mixed up with your indicators for sustainable urban development. They are vastly different. Right, so jumping right in, okay, let's not waste any time. First indicator we have is the Economist Intelligence Unit Global Liveability Index. So this is by the Economist. Many of you have heard of this the Economist group, right? They publish a lot of articles about the economy or that kind of good stuff. Essentially, this is the research and analysis department, okay, the division of the Economist group. So what they do is they basically want to quantify any sort of challenge, okay, that might be presented to an individual's lifestyle in any location. So in any city, they are trying to assess what are the possible challenges that one faces, as well as the good things that they are facing as well. So as a result, they are all basically assigned, each city is assigned a rating, okay, on relative comfort. So essentially, they are basically comparing it with one another, how comfortable a city is or how livable a city is over a vast number of 30 different aspects that they used to measure. So the good things, okay, remember indicators, we are always looking at our evaluation, right? So the evaluation for this Economist Intelligence Unit's Global Liveability Index is that it is updated every single year, which is good, okay, because you notice that a lot of indicators, they tend to update once every 2 or 3 years, and then as a result, the data becomes very inaccurate, right? There could be a sudden jump, and you're like, whoa, what happened? And one more thing is that it covers 140 cities, which is not bad, okay, it's quite a lot of cities to actually be covering, but the only issue is that it is still based on subjective judgment as well as the agenda by the Economist group themselves. Okay, essentially they decide what aspects they want to measure and they decide how they want to compare between the cities as well as the rating that they want to give. So this is the only issue. It may not be a worldwide standard. Okay, it's more on base of their own judgment that they want to exercise. Alright, so the next indicator we have would be Mercer's Quality of Life Index. So Mercer's Quality of Life Index is actually by a global consulting firm, called Mercer, okay? What actually happens is that they aim to provide multinational firms and governments quality of living information in more than 231 cities. So you notice, first of all, this one already has more cities than the Economist group one, right? And what they want to do is they want to basically explain to all these governments and firms, okay, over a course of 39 different factors, how well the city is doing in terms of how livable it is. All right, so these factors come in the form of all sorts of factors. So things like urban legibility could be one of the factors, right? How accessible is your public transport, right? How is the income disparity like? So these are just some of the examples that are part of these indicators. So as the evaluation really suggests, right, it covers a very broad range of indicators. That's a good thing. But it also does rely on subjective judgment because ultimately of the day, they are still a firm. Every firm still has their own motive, okay, and there's only a small number of surveys. Right? What do I mean by small number of surveys? Means that in a sense, although yes, they do cover over 231 cities, the way their number of factors are actually being used and the categories is not actually a lot. Right, you'll notice later on that there's another indicator, the Lee Kuan Yew public policy indicator, which actually has, I think, over 80 different indicators to measure this quality of life. So the third one you have is Monocle's Most Livable Cities Index. Monocle is actually a magazine, okay? It's a very, it's quite a pricey magazine, okay? You must be either have a lot of extra disposable income or you must be rich or you love that magazine so much that you actually go and buy it. Which is why, and as you can see in the second line, okay, it is targeted at the wealthy, mobile and cosmopolitan reader. Right, so it's more for those with money to spare. They will buy this magazine to actually read it. And what it does is that it actually updates people on which are the most livable cities in the world today. So, for example, the first could be Singapore, second could be Sweden, for example, third could be Perth, or maybe not Perth, maybe another city, okay, essentially. But what they do is they cover a lot of things such as global affairs, businesses, and then in one of these categories is which the most livable city is as well. Right, so the only downside to this is that it does study only 11 indicators. So to take note of this is very, very little compared to the rest. Okay, hence it is not a great index as it is. It does have the least number of indicators, and it's also a subjective assessment on only 25 cities. 25 cities is very little. You think about the Mercer's quality of life one, right? It covered over 231 cities. This one only covers 25 cities. It's vastly lesser. It's very, very little. Okay, and it also covers very little indicators as well. Plus, it is only available to some people. So not everyone has access to this. You must really have money to go and buy a magazine to actually read up on this. So there's only a downside to this, which is why when it comes to indicators, I don't recommend you use Monocle's Most Livable City Index, but I recommend you use it more as an anomaly to say that this index, this indicator is not exactly the best indicator out there. Apologies on the header. This is actually wrong. This should be to measure livability. Yeah? I'm just going to put live over here. I think the previous slide also was wrong. Yeah. So these are all livability. It's not SUD. Yep. All right. So, okay, likewise over here, it should be livability. Okay, so the last policy that we have, not policy, the last indicator we have will be the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy Global Livable Cities Index. Okay, so this is basically a school of public policy. Public policy is basically a school which sets, like, it's just like public policies, right? They help to essentially create new ideas in order to govern the city better. Right, so it considers over 85 indicators, which is crazy. It is the most out of all of the indexes. Over here, 85 different indicators. And essentially what it does, okay, is to cover around 64 cities, as I've stated down here. Right, basically all of these indicators, the reason why I didn't state what the indicators, not indicators, what the aspects to these indicators are is because they all cover roughly the same aspects. They cover urban legibility, they cover income inequality, they cover noise pollution, air pollution. All of them cover all these livability factors, okay, that I've just gone through in the previous video. So I'm not going to state it here because all of them cover the same thing, but the only difference is in the number as well as the number of indicators as well as the number of cities as well as how often this is being updated. So the only downside to this Lee Kuan Yew one is that it is not published yearly, so it can be outdated sometimes, right? It's only published once every few years. I think it was like 5 years or something like that. So it tends to be very, very outdated after a while. So that is one of the downsides to this indicator to measure livability. Okay, so once again, we come to our exam requirements. So exam requirements, you first need to understand the different indicators used to measure livability. This one I've already gone through. Like I've said, okay, if you want to go in depth, we just need to remember that all of them cover roughly the same factors. And these factors are all the factors that I've already covered in the previous video. So go ahead and watch that one so you know what I'm talking about. So take note that they are not the same as those indicators used to measure SUD, Sustainable Urban Development. Those is like your SDG 11, all the other types, okay, your GRI. It is not the same as measuring livability. And one more thing is that these can be the smaller mark essay questions. It could be a case study question asking you to assess statistics that has been extracted from a magazine. You need to identify. If they say that it's from a magazine, you instantly know that it is going to be Monocle's quality of life index. So you just need to make sure that you really... most livable city index. So you just need to make sure you know what the indicators are, and if you see something that is popping out, okay, make sure you can identify it. If not, you should be definitely fine with this part. Right, so I've already gone through what I've needed to cover for livability, both the factors for livability as well as the indicators. That is what your syllabus requires for almost all of you watching this. So if not, that is all I have. To the next video, I think I will maybe be covering somewhere along elderly or something. More on the later topics, maybe waste management as well. So if you did enjoy this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up as well as subscribe to the channel. It really does help me out a lot. I would see you guys in the next one. If you have any questions, leave them down below. If not, yeah, I'll see you guys then. Bye bye.